Denver 8 TV, your city, your source.
The impact of DNA in criminal investigations has been incredible in recent years. It has generated hundreds of leads in cold cases in Denver alone, and there is still room for expanding the use of DNA to prevent and solve crime. Denver Crime Lab Director Greg LaBerge and CODIS Administrator Eric Duval join Denver DA Mitch Morrissey on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. Hello, everyone. I'm Tamara Banks. Welcome to Dialogue Denver DA. Mitch, great to see you again.
Good to see you, Tamara.
And we have two incredible guests here today, Greg LaBerge with the Crime Lab with the Denver Police Department and Eric Duval with CODIS. So, Eric, I want to start with you. Can you first tell me what that acronym CODIS stands for?
Yeah. So, CODIS, it's spelled C-O-D-I-S, and it stands for the Combined DNA Index System.
Okay. So everybody's heard a lot about DNA. We've talked about it over the past few years. But Eric, tell us, one of the biggest strides in using DNA to fight crime was the passage of Cady's Law, right? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yes. Cady's Law was passed in Colorado and took effect in October of 2010. And Cady's Law provided for felony arrestees in the state of Colorado to be collected for DNA. And once those offenders or individuals have a docket number and they've been charged, then their DNA is put into the database and compared against any unsolved crimes in the state of Colorado. And to date, just the city and county of Denver has solved over 400 cases with the passage of that law.
Hmm. Mitch, that's a pretty big move. I mean, that's moving the needle significantly.
It was, and at the time, you know, Greg and I have frequent flyers at the Capitol when it comes to changing DNA law in Colorado. I think the first time we changed it was in 2008 when we said, listen, you've got to take DNA from all felons, no matter what they get sentenced to. There was a time when you had to go to prison to give your DNA. Well, there were a lot of people getting convicted of felonies that weren't going to prison in this state. In fact, the majority of people that get convicted of felonies get probation, community corrections. Those offenders were flying under the radar screen. So we went in and got that law changed in 08. And then with the help of Jayanne Sepich, Cady's was her daughter, who was raped and murdered in New Mexico. She came here and testified in 2010, we were able to get the law changed to start taking DNA from people, just like Eric said, that get charged with a felony. So they get arrested, they take their sample, they swab their cheek, just like when they take their fingerprints at the same time as they're booked. But we can't put it in the database till they get charged with the felony. If they get charged with a misdemeanor, or if they don't get charged at all, their DNA doesn't go in. It was a tough fight. The good news is that the United States Supreme Court has ruled on what we do here in Colorado since that time in a Maryland case, the King case, and that was only about a year and a half ago, and they ruled that what we're doing in Colorado is constitutional, it doesn't violate the Fourth Amendment, and so we're full steam ahead with Cady's Law.
And as you said, it doesn't go into the database until the person is actually charged.
Charged. They have to be charged. Otherwise, it's just destroyed, thrown away.
Can you gentlemen give us some examples of cases that have actually worked well due to the Cady's Law?
Well, you know, the critical thing about Cady's Law is it helps you identify the offender that much sooner. And if you look at the history of these guys, many of them, if they had been identified by Cady's Law sooner, they would not have committed a number of other violent crimes against children, against women. And so we had an individual last year who we caught him through Cady's Law. He was one of those guys that he knocked over an old man in a grocery store parking lot. He got arrested, he went into the database, and we got a hit on him then on three different sexual assaults. And you know, the interesting thing, and I think we'll get to this, is talking about taking DNA on misdemeanor convictions. Right. He had a misdemeanor conviction. He had a felony that was pled down to a misdemeanor and was before Cady's Law, so he stayed out of the database. And that allowed him then to rape three or four different women as opposed to catching him the first woman that he raped. And that's why this law is so important, because it prevents and catches these serial perpetrators before they victimize numerous other people.
There's also data a few years old now out of the UK. We had a meeting about 4 years ago at the Aspen Institute up in Aspen. We brought a guest speaker in from the UK who ran the professional standards unit for the UK police, for the entire UK. Mm-hmm. And they showed, using their database, they looked at it over 20 years, and they found that the earlier that somebody was in the database in their criminal career, the more likely they were to exit being a criminal earlier. Mm-hmm. So if you look at misdemeanors and things that are lower level crimes qualifying you for the DNA data bank, those people getting caught earlier will prevent them from continuing on to a criminal career for their whole lives. So the later you got into the database, generally in your 20s or 30s, it didn't have as much of an effect on your overall criminal career. Those people would go on to 40, 45 being criminals in terms of their age. But the earlier you got them, right, they would exit. They would be more of a deterrent for them to continue on a criminal path. And so that's an important point, I think.
Yeah, because you're catching the folks at an early stage in their
correct
criminal career, so to speak, right, versus them becoming career criminals for a very long time.
And you can divert them earlier. So once you identify them, not only are you preventing those future crimes, you can divert them into a more, let's say, amenable career path,
yeah,
in the society, and not be getting them into the jails and getting them as frequent flyers or people that we're constantly seeing back and forth in and out of the criminal justice system. So it has a preventative effect in the longer term.
So Eric, talk about how all of this interfaces with CODIS. What's the role there?
Sure. So CODIS is a series of computer terminals all across the country. We have a terminal here in Denver, and we're what's referred to as a local lab. And our local lab is connected to the state lab, the Colorado Bureau of Investigation, and they have all the offenders and arrestees from the state of Colorado. And our computer talks to theirs, and we're uploading or sending samples from cases that we work. So far this year, we've sent over 1,000 profiles, DNA profiles developed in all types of cases. We've sent those up to the state level, and they're compared against all of the different offenders that are in there, as well as cases from the other laboratories in Colorado to look for pattern crimes as well. And then the next level of CODIS is the national level. And so within Colorado, all of our local labs connect to the state computer, and then the state computer connects to all 50 states and the federal labs as well. So there's comparisons of our cases to offenders located in Washington State and Florida and New York, and we receive hits. In fact, today I received a hit from the state of Maryland to one of our unsolved cases. So, you know, offenders travel across the country, relocate, and they have a qualifying offense in a different state, and it helps to solve one of our cases.
So it sounds like the thing that CODIS can do that some of the other organizations haven't been able to do is, from DNA sampling, you can connect people across the country and then share that information with other agencies locally, statewide, and nationwide.
Yes, and as the local CODIS administrator, I kind of serve as a gatekeeper of that information, and I'm communicating with the other labs across the country, speaking to that administrator in Maryland, letting him know about my case information, him sending the offender details to me that I can pass on to our investigator here in Denver. And in situations where there's cases that are linked together, I can share my case details along with my investigator and get their investigator, and our detective can speak to theirs, and they can look for similarities in the cases and look for a pattern and, you know, kind of work together in that respect.
If you know somebody committed 2 crimes or 8 crimes, there may be a clue in one of those crimes that when you tell the other 8 investigators, well, this is what we had in our case. We had a partial plate on a license. Oh, wait a minute. And go back and look. Well, we have that plate. And so there, it starts the discussion of good investigators. Remember, DNA is a lead. That's what it is. It doesn't necessarily tell you who did it. It gives you a lead. It narrows the field of who to go and talk to and who to look at. And so when you give that kind of a lead, either if it's a case-to-case link because the same DNA profile was found, or if it's an offender to a case that we have here in Denver, it gives the detective somebody to go talk to, or it gives them another group of detectives to go and talk to that may then trigger something that solves both cases.
And are you proponents of collecting DNA at the arrest of a misdemeanor?
Not at the arrest of a misdemeanor. We have run a bill a couple of years, got it through the House, not last year, but the year before, and that was to take DNA on misdemeanor convictions. That's after the person has gone to trial or pled guilty. A lot of felons plead guilty to misdemeanors. Mm-hmm. And what we're trying to do, if you think about it, I would say it's about 8% of your population that commits about 80 to 85% of the kind of crimes we're talking about. So our target should be to try to get that 8% into this database so we can save the kind of resources and victims that DNA saves. We know DNA saves an incredible amount of money in law enforcement. It saves an incredible amount of money in the judicial system, and it saves victims from being victimized. So if you think about half of your criminals are not in that database because they're getting convicted of misdemeanors. Mm. And this isn't something that we're just making up out of whole cloth. We know, for instance, that New York takes DNA on misdemeanors. So since 2006, they've had about 1,850 hits on misdemeanors. And those hits are to rapes and murders. About 1,600 of the 1,850 hits are to homicides and rapes. That's an incredible statistic. That shows you the power of DNA. It also shows you that if somebody is stealing the petty cash drawer, they may be that serial rapist you've been looking for 10 years. They go to jail for petty theft, and boom, you hit on those violent crimes that they've been committing at night or whenever they're getting the opportunity.
So that was going to be my next question about New York. They have the misdemeanor piece in process now, so that seems to be working for them quite well.
About a month ago or so, Eric had the opportunity to talk to the New York CODIS administrator. He may have some information about that.
Yeah, it was interesting to hear about the cases that they were solving with that, find out kind of how the workload changes, how it would change for, you know, me working with CODIS, and, you know, the amount of individuals that went in to the database has gone up by a third. So, you know, there are some people that are, you know, committing both felonies and misdemeanors, but, you know, there's a third of the size of their database that has gone up based on that, and the number of hits that they've had. You know, Mitch gave you the number, but, you know, 16%, which is a big jump for the amount of work that you're doing, the number of cases that are coming across, you know, our desks in the lab with new investigative leads to pass on to investigators.
So with DNA, there's really no place to hide.
No, definitely not.
Yeah. Well, we're going to take a quick break here. We've been talking with some experts of DNA and how crime labs are getting those bad guys behind bars. We'll be back in just a moment with more Dialogue Denver DA. Stay with us. Welcome back to Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks with Mitch Morrissey. This is the portion of the show where we talk about a legal term, and this month's legal definition is mandatory reporting. And mandatory reporting requires certain people to report concerns of abuse or neglect of both children and the elderly. So are these people, Mitch, who are in charge of the care of these folks?
They can be, but it depends on what you're talking about. Like a school teacher that sees signs of abuse has a legal responsibility to report that to the police within a certain period of time. That's true for doctors, for instance, that are taking care of elderly people. We just recently changed the law in Colorado, for instance, and we got a new class of mandatory reporters for crimes against the elderly. So you wouldn't think, but a banker has the responsibility of reporting to the police immediately within 24 hours or something occurs that looks like, you know, somebody's cleaning out somebody's bank account or that type of thing. And the reason you have these reporting responsibilities is because a lot of people think, hey, it's not my business, I'm not going to report this, I'm suspicious, that type of thing. And it really, it mandates, it requires that you report. A few years ago, I charged a principal in the Denver Public Schools for failing to report a sexual assault that occurred in one of her classrooms. The case resolved and was taken care of, and eventually it was dismissed. But it put the entire school system in Denver on alert that this was their responsibility, that they have this responsibility. So when it comes to kids and it comes to the elderly, people that you really have to watch out for, and a lot of people interact with them and might think, oh, this isn't really my business, that type of thing. No, the law doesn't allow that. You have a responsibility to report those things to the police.
We need those eyes and ears out there for those most vulnerable in our community.
We really do, and we have seen lives that have been saved. We've seen people's complete savings that have been saved because a banker made a call, because a teacher made a call and saved a little kid from dying from some type of abuse they were suffering. So it's an important law, and I got to tell you, most of the people in this state, if that's their responsibility, they take their responsibility very seriously.
Yeah, I bet. Well, getting back to the topic of the month, we were talking about the power of DNA. And Greg, I want to ask you if you could elaborate a little bit more about how, if we get young offenders into the database when they're teenagers, that right. they have less of a chance of becoming career criminals.
That's what the study in the UK, really the take-home message from the study I mentioned earlier from the UK was that if they're into the DNA database basically under 16, the chances that they reoffend is actually much less than you would expect, and they get out of their criminal careers prior to the age of 20. Whereas if you don't get someone until they're in their 20s, they may still have 20 more years of offending ahead of them, even if they're in the DNA database. So there's a deterrent effect in the teenage population that they know they're in a database, and it has an effect on them not committing crimes in the future. So it works.
Getting to those young people sooner than later.
Right.
Eric, talk a little bit about the work that you do with CODIS. I mean, your title is administrator, but you are actually in there, sleeves rolled up, doing the work.
Yeah, I'm also a fully trained forensic DNA analyst, and so I kind of split my day between those two roles. So as a DNA analyst, I'm working in the lab, generating these DNA profiles, bringing them back to my desk, making the comparisons, issuing reports, sending them off to the detectives and the district attorney's office to provide the information in the cases that they've submitted for cases that end up progressing through the legal system. I testify as an expert witness at the courthouse, providing information to the jury about the work that I've done on a particular case. And then my CODIS role involves, you know, going through all of those different matches that we get every week and evaluating them and, you know, speaking to the state lab and trading information with other labs across the country and sending the information that I get on to investigators across the city, whether it's a property crimes detective in one of the districts or one of our homicide detectives, or sending information about a cold case that's been sitting dormant for a very long time but has received a CODIS hit by a new individual going into the database. So I wear a few different hats in the lab to not only get those profiles generated to be submitted for CODIS and for searching, but then also pass that information along.
I bet your work really does impact the cold cases in particular.
It really does, yeah.
Tamara, let me tell you this. We used to get excited when there was one hit. I remember we would get a call. We had a CODIS hit today. Now Eric deals with maybe 40, 50 CODIS hits at any given time. And
it's more work. There's no question it's more work. But it's the kind of work that brings results. It's the kind of work that gives that detective that may be working on five or six rapes the answer they need to go out and solve that. So, you know, that is the amazing thing about the Denver Police Crime Lab and the people that work there. This guy's one of the rising stars there. And he will work and work and work to get that answer. And it's exciting. And the work that he does is, I think that, you know, if I wasn't a trial lawyer, that's something that I would have really enjoyed doing. Not that I'm smart enough, but they are making a difference in people's lives every single time they do something. If there's been a mistake made in a match and Eric catches it and somebody's name doesn't get sent to that detective and there isn't a warrant that goes out for him, that's equally as important as providing that information that says, this is the rapist you're looking for. And that's why they have to be unbiased. They do an excellent job at what they do. If they make a mistake, they admit it. They find out what the situation was and try to prevent it again. The caliber of the people that work in this lab are second to none in my 30 years of working all over this city. The idea that you can't make a mistake and that you have to be beyond question is something that is the entire work ethic of the Denver Police Crime Lab.
So on that note, Eric, talk a little bit about the process of protecting the integrity of all this evidence and all this DNA, because that sounds pretty intense as well.
Yeah. So, you know, watching those crime dramas on television, you know, they talk about hits in the database and pictures and addresses are popping up. And, you know, that's not the case with the CODIS database. Yeah. You know, there's a lot of samples are randomized, so they all have unique identifiers. But no one person holds the key to, like, all the information in a particular database. In the entire database. So, you know, the samples that we submit up to the state level have a unique identifier related to the cases that we're working on here in Denver. And they would result in a match to an offender with a unique identifier that's just a string of numbers and letters that is then confirmed by the state lab to ensure that they're sending me the name of the right individual, that the sample IDs match one another, and that they've done their check. In situations where individuals have more than one sample in the database, they do a very thorough paperwork check to ensure that the same individual was processed for both of those samples. All of their personal identifying information matches. For samples that only have one of that individual in the database, they actually redo the lab work prior to sending me the name in order to confirm that individual. And so that confirmation process adds time, obviously, mm-hmm. to the notification for our investigators, but it's very important to ensure the quality of the data. The CODIS database is located on a secure network that, you know, only connects to that state computer and the computers all across the country through a network that the FBI has set up.
Are you often called to testify in court?
Not usually on mm-hmm. the CODIS cases. That's very kind of common now that there are CODIS hits on cases. Mm-hmm. I do speak to the both the DAs and the defense attorneys about cases and that have CODIS hits and kind of what it meant and the timing of everything. But, you know, we don't talk about CODIS during a trial due to, you know, the fact that that individual then has a prior felony. Mm-hmm. And so that's not part of something that's brought up while we're, you know, testifying. But right. I do, you know, provide education to both the district attorneys as well as the defense attorneys about, you know, what the process was for this individual being linked to a particular case.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we really work out a stipulation when it comes to a CODIS hit. One, Eric can't come in and testify to the CODIS hit. What he has to do is make sure the detectives get another sample from the individual and they run it, and that's the match that they testify to in court. That's to keep CODIS out of this process. Mm-hmm. And usually both sides want to keep CODIS out of the process. The defense doesn't want the jury sitting there thinking, oh, there was a hit in the DNA database. Well, that means this guy's a convicted felon. You know, our system is set up for trying someone for the crime that we say they committed, not because they're a bad guy. So they don't want the fact that their guy's in some database. They don't want the jury considering that.
So we usually work out a stipulation. But on some of the cases that Eric's been responsible for, some of these 30-year-old homicides, you know, it does kind of seem like, well, this guy just dropped out of the sky. And what really happened is the guy got into the DNA database, or we caught up with that old case, Eric processed it, got a profile, put it into CODIS, and we got the hit. And I've got to tell you, when you're talking to a mother that's waited 30 years to find out what happened to her young daughter who was raped and murdered, was a waitress, and then 30 years later you can say, hey, the man that did this is the man we just convicted and being held accountable now for a crime he thought he got away with. And unfortunately, he was living in Kansas and he committed about 20 other crimes at the same time. Right. You know, that's really rewarding work for us. And I know it's rewarding work for everybody in the lab. It's a program that we built. It's second to nowhere in the world. Greg can tell you. We've solved over 300 cases. We've held over 100. We've held 110 people accountable. That's twice as many as anywhere in the world.
That's just cold case.
That's just cold
case. Just cold case. The other thing to point out is productivity. You know, it's important to point out that Eric mentioned earlier there were about 1,100 DNA profiles placed into the database this year by our laboratory. Well, of those 1,100, we got about 660 that matched somebody. So you're looking at about a 66% return.
Wow.
So out of every 10 cases that go in, we're getting information on 6 to 7 that gives you a name to follow up on right away. That's dramatic.
That is dramatic. And I wonder if people, if the public actually understands that. I mean, maybe that's the importance of this show, is to get let people know how critically important DNA is.
Absolutely.
And about 30, in Katie's law situations, about 37% of the time, then we're able to file a criminal case. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's things like the statute of limitations is run, so we can't bring the case, even though we knew who did it in property crimes. There's some things, sometimes we can't find the victim, and the victim doesn't want to cooperate with our prosecution. We know exactly how many of those percentage-wise, but about 37, almost 40%, of the 60% he's describing, we're able to file. And when that, you know, when you start using DNA, for instance, on a crime that you never used it on before,
right,
you start to catch those guys, you start to reduce the crime rate, and you save the whole city, the whole system, everybody. It makes Denver a better place to live.
Absolutely. Gentlemen, thank you so much for your time. Really you. Interesting yes, conversation. Thanks. Appreciate it. Thank you to Greg LaBerge, Director of Denver's Crime Lab, and Eric Duval, CODIS Administrator, for joining us on this edition of Dialogue Denver DA. I'm Tamara Banks. We'll see you next time.
Denver 8 TV, your city, your source.